This video is about data visualization using conditional formatting. Why is it called data visualization? Because if you look at the data and try to read it, it's not going to work. The fifth number you read, you have forgotten the first number. You will not make any sense out of it. So, what if we put something visual there so that you don't have to read? You can just see and make some sense out of it. For example, I just put a bar chart inside the data. Now, anybody in the world will understand what is happening. No reading involved. Now, conditional formatting, let me show you. If you open the conditional formatting, there are many options. Ask yourself, have I used all the options? No, most probably not. Then why did Microsoft give all options? The natural answer, oh, for someone else. No, it is not for someone else. You have to understand which of those options to use when. And that's what we are going to do. So I'm going to use this set of numbers and show you with the same data how much more you can understand by using different types of visuals. We have already seen the data bars, right? Many people make a mistake with data bars because notice there is a negative sign. Negative sign automatically becomes red. Many people, when they don't see any number which is negative, sometimes choose the color itself, the base color as red, and then a negative number comes. Then what happens? Both sides are red. That's very confusing. So as far as possible, if you expect negative numbers, don't use red as the base color. Of course, you're not limited to those colors. You can go and customize everything in that dialog. In fact, that's what we are going to do. When you go there, a complex looking dialog opens. Don't worry, we are going to learn this. So first thing we see is show bar only. That's a very useful thing because bars and data, they are going to overlap somewhere. Bars and numbers overlapping is visually confusing. Let's say you are showing this in PowerPoint. Nobody is interested in those numbers. Just show them the pattern. Now, how do I hide the numbers? That's the option there. Show bar only. It looks much better from a report presentation perspective. The look and feel can be changed from colors and borders. There's a separate area for what to do with the negative axis as well. But having said that, probably the most important thing there is the minimum and maximum. Currently, what is it doing? It's looking at the minimum and maximum in the data and deciding how the bars change. Right now, the maximum is 103. Now, if I change some other number to 300, not just that bar, everything else changes because the range changed. Most of the time, this is the correct way. But suppose you are trying to show percentages, then some number changing, you don't want everyone to change. That is the time you put minimum at 0 and maximum as 100. So minimum, maximum should be customized based on the context. Now we are going to keep the data same, but I want to see the top three values. What do I do? Yes, there is a top three option. So I applied that. I want to give top three this color. I also want to see bottom three. No problem. I'll put another color. Now let's play with those numbers a little and see how it works. Right now, the topmost number is 103. And it is showing me three top numbers. What if I put another number, 103, somewhere else? What happens? It shows both. Now if I put one more, then what happens? So you see, as the data changes, it is dynamically and smartly applying the formatting. That's important to know. We can see top three and bottom three, different color. Great. Now I want to see above average. Of course, I'll use a different color. Three colors now. No. What happened? When I applied above average, the highest color is gone. Why? Because if some number is above average, anyway, that will be in top three. Now that's a problem. I want to see top three, bottom three and above average separately for whatever reason. Most people don't know how to do it. So that's where the real crux of conditional formatting comes into picture, the rules area. So go to conditional formatting, look at the rules. You'll see three rules here. The rules are in the order in which we added them. But because we added the above average last, that is overriding the earlier rules. In case of top three and bottom three, there was no conflict because the same number will never be in top three and bottom three. But in this case, between above average and highest, there is a problem. So the top one is taking precedence. Now, if you don't want, there is up, down, arrow there, rearrange them, and now it will work exactly as expected. When you have complex conditional formatting, you must understand what is happening by coming to the dialog. In fact, I would say you should come to this dialog and apply conditional formatting, because that way you will not get confused and you will avoid mistakes. If you want specific control over a range or data above or below something, then of course we have greater than, less than, between the traditional ones. The thing which most people don't notice is when you go to that dialog, yes, you're supposed to type a number there. No, not necessarily. Remember, this is Excel. So whatever I'm typing there can be a formula. And if you use a formula, then you can have some amazing type of conditional formatting, because what it is comparing against itself is dynamically adjusted. Now, instead of bar charts, I'm going to just put color, but two different colors. It's called a color scale. We choose one color for the lowest value and another color for highest value. So in our case, 10 is the lowest and 103 is the highest. No problem. But what happens to other numbers in between? Which color do they get? The idea is they don't get yellow, they don't get green. They get a mixture of yellow and green. Now, how much yellow comes, how much green comes, that proportion is decided based on where that number is. If the number is nearer to 10, more yellow will come, less green. If the number is nearer to 103, more green, less yellow. Now, all that calculation we don't have to do, Excel is doing it. But look at the visual understanding now. Without reading the numbers, we can see the distribution and pattern. But while I am showing you all this, I'll also tell you, if the numbers are less, like we have right now, you should not use color scales, because the number of shades are too little to make any sense out of it. So when should you use color scale? When you have large number of items. Now in this case, if I put data bar, which we already know worked earlier, it's going to look very sad because there are too many bars, you can't understand anything. But instead, if I use color scales, look at the difference. There are clusters which you can see. This is a low value cluster. This is a high value cluster. There is no other way in which you could have even noticed that. And that is called data visualization, understanding patterns without reading data. So heat map and color scales, which have gradients in it, are generally difficult to understand. So use it only when necessary and make sure your audience knows how to interpret the gradients. We saw the bar charts. How many bar chart types will be there? For every unique number, there will be a slightly different bar. For color scale, again, if there is a lot of variation, every cell will have a different color. So bar chart and color scale have a lot of variation. Sometimes we don't want too much variation. We just want few categories: high, medium, low, delayed or not delayed, pass or fail. Those kind of things are best done using icon sets, because icon sets are graphics. Graphics means it's sort of a picture, and picture itself has a meaning. So you have a separate picture for high, separate for low, done. Now, if you go to icon sets, there are 20 types available. Don't look at the icons first. Look at the categories. There are only 4 categories: directional, shapes, indicators, and ratings. What does that mean? Direction matters means something is above something, below something. So there is some above, below context at least. Like that, shapes, where there is no direction, but you just want that shape and the color. So high means red, low means yellow, something like that. Then we have indicators, pass, fail, or red flag, yellow flag. And then there are ratings. Ratings means you have some kind of score there, or you have a project and that project is progressing halfway, 75%, like that. So choose the correct icon in the correct place. So we are going to just apply directional 3 icons to start with. Now let's go and understand how to use them. So I have applied directional arrow icons. Now what happened? It did not ask me where to put yellow, where to put red. It just put it. How is Excel deciding who gets green, who gets red? So let's go to the rules dialog, then you will understand. It's looking at the minimum 10, maximum 103, dividing that range into 3 equal pieces. So 0 to 33% gets red, 33 to 67% gets yellow, and 67 and above gets green. That is by default. Now, this is a very important thing to understand. Whenever you see a drop down, open it. And nowhere is it more relevant than here. most people have never opened the dropdown of that percent. And in the process, they don't realize that I could have put a direct number as well. Because many people have a benchmark. I have a target, I have a stretch target, and those are not percentages. Those are absolute numbers. If I want it that way, I should not use percentage. I should put actual values and choose number from there. Another interesting thing there is percentile, which is very often required in reporting. And of course, for maximum flexibility, you have formulas as well. This is how you customize exactly what icon goes where. Fine. But there is one more important thing. For whatever reason, in my case, higher value should be red. Because maybe it's not sales. In sales, higher value is good. In this case, the number which I'm showing is number of defects. Defects are bad. So higher defects should be red. Now, I don't have to change anything there. There is an option called reverse icon order, which does exactly the same thing. And like the bar chart, we have show icons only where numbers are automatically hidden. Oh, there is one more really interesting thing. For example, some people say highest value I want to show up arrow, lowest value I want to show down arrow. But for the middle value, I don't want an arrow pointing. I just want a dot there. That is possible. How? Because there are drop downs for the icons themselves. So for each icon, you can choose from any of the 20 icons. That makes it really flexible. We have seen almost all of the conditional formatting options available except the most important one, and that happens to be formula. You go to the rules dialog, and the sixth one is most powerful because it's a formula. So you put any formula there. If the formula returns true, the formatting is applied. If not, formatting is not applied. Sounds very simple, but this makes it really flexible. Let's take a real example. In fact, if you have thought of conditional formatting, I'm sure you needed this, but you didn't know how to do it. The objective is simple. I have some data, Jan, Feb, March, April, May, and I have total. Now the total is something which I want to compare with my target. Let's say my target is 300. So I want to highlight the rows which are below 300. Very good. What am I going to do? I'm going to select the whole range, put the formula which says equal to what below 300? Well, I'm going to take the current cell because there is active cell and then apply the conditional formatting. That's not going to work. You have to understand how conditional formatting is applied. When you select, the active cell is there. The formula is being interpreted in the context of the active cell. So for this cell, yes, I have to take 188 because that's the row. But for the next row, I don't want to take the above row. I want to take the current row. So now if you look at the formula, the row as well as the column is fixed because you see dollar sign there. We want something to be variable. The column has to be fixed, row has to be variable. So remove the dollar sign below the number and then everything works beautifully. People have struggled to get this done and when they finally realize this, that's literally ecstatic. Bottom line, I'm sure you can use conditional formatting more effectively now and think there must be millions of people who will benefit from this knowledge. So now the ball is in your court. You like, share, subscribe, comments, queries, all that makes YouTube understand that this video is useful. It is going to show it to many more people, and that's how you and me can make the world a more efficient place. So that's it for now. Thank you.